Let's come back in about 3 to 5 minutes into the second segment, because now we are getting to the real core of our discussion. We will be back and engage with our listeners as well.
Thank you.
Welcome back, colleagues. As stated, I think Sylvia had started really sharing with us the practicality of it. And I hope Michael will get time to share with the listeners how we are using the manual to actually integrate this traditional African LEKGOTLA methodology into the modern way of conducting meetings. Should we allow Sylvia to take it further and share with us the experience? And yes. When does the LEKGOTLA sit? Over to you, Sylvia.
Thank you. Yes, thanks. And I just want to comment Ntate Rammutla for the elaboration, because I think it brings the perspective much clearer in the explanation that you've just given us in terms of the alignment and into it. And the practicality of it just becomes something that, as I said earlier on, that it's a methodology that is conscious, you know. But maybe because when we're sitting in such a meeting, the chief has done it so many times that one might just think it's just a natural thing. But I want to emphasize that we have to understand that it's a conscious way of conducting such a meeting. You know, because the difference, as we said, of a setup where that Frans has just mentioned, Mike, in terms of when you walk into the boardroom, there's this big chair, you know, that you don't even want to be sitting next to it. To the contrary, the chief does have such a chair, you know, in the royal house. But that chair consciously doesn't get used during the time of LEKGOTLA. It has got its own use and its own opportunity and time to be used, but definitely not at the LEKGOTLA. Mm. At the LEKGOTLA, all the members that are to attend a meeting or the discussion, as it might be called, they are all sitting in the secular format under the tree. You know, I still cannot... maybe I have never got the opportunity to can sit with the elders to understand how does that tree grow, because it is a huge tree, you know, with a big shade. You know, unfortunately, I've never asked what type of a tree that is, but it has a big shade. And what is being done there is that round the tree, they have then created something like some people will call it lapa or a stoop. Yeah. You know, but it's done in a format of like a chair or an area where people can sit comfortably, you know. So all that in our latest thing we could be saying, all that it misses, it's like the cushions that you could put on there, but there are no cushions. It's just a big circle of cement that people are sitting comfortably on the... Yes, you know, exactly like in terms of that. So they will be sitting around there, and a meeting get called by the chief, of course, as Mike has explained. You know, he will then call the chief, and all the members that are supposed to attend that meeting, they will come. I said earlier on that it's a serious session as well. Remember, it's called by the chief, the respect of the chief, and understanding that he won't just call it. He will then call it when it's necessary, and as Mike has explained, and he will explain the purpose of the meeting. So the people come to the meeting being prepared. So they are dressed up. Yes, they get dressed up for such a LEKGOTLA meeting with their jackets and whatever. It's under the tree. It's in the rural area. It does get hot. So as I say, you know, they would have taken their jacket respectively and requested to take it off. And then they will put it on their laps. You know, so you will see that they have jackets, and it looks very interestingly, I think, at the time where if they were the recent time where we could be taking pictures of them, you will be seeing some a pattern of men sitting around the tree with the jackets on their laps, you know, as if it's like a practice or whatever, but like it's genuinely practically hot. You know, and they have to take it off, but they still shown that respect of coming to that meeting. So the chief will be sitting amongst them. So if you were to arrive there late and you don't know the chief, you would not easily identify which one is the chief, because he's just in the circle. he's equal to them. He's a servant like them at that particular moment. Only when he takes the sticks, the stick, the induku, and he's then leading the meeting with it, because he will be the first one that will be having it so that he can hand it over to the people to talk. You know, so that's how you will identify that this one is the chief. But otherwise, the entire meeting, the facilitation methodology is in such a way that the chief allows the people to speak freely. They respect each other. They will ensure, and everybody knows the rules. Everybody understands the protocol. When the meeting is about to start, the chief will be holding the indugu, and he wouldn't be saying anything. He will be holding it, being quiet, being silent. And around then, everybody, even though they were like having their little chats as like people that would have walked together and whatever, as soon as the meeting is about to start, when that indugu gets held by the chief and he's quiet, it's an indication. There is no verbal words that are said that we are now starting. But they will then see with that indugu the way that it gets held and the chief holding it and being silent. So everybody will automatically become silent. They know it's the beginning of the meeting. So the chief will then present the topic to be discussed, and then he will be tell them, this is the issue that is happening in our village. We want to deal with this matter, and this is what we need to do. You know, he wants the idea on how we can then do that particular issue or deal with it. Now, I mentioned earlier on that it's like a strategy formulation session, you know. So when you formulate a strategy, the chief basically will then say that this is the matter that we want to deal with it. The indunas or the people that are in the meeting, they will be coming up with the ideas on how then we can formalize the strategy and how are we going to implement it, you know, when we go outside. How will it be deployed to the rest of the villagers? So at that particular time, you could understand that there will be times where there will be what we call a brainstorming session. And, you know, during that particular time when the people talk, people will have a speaker on the table once he's handed the indugu. Everybody keeps quiet and they allow the person who's having the indugu the floor and the opportunity to talk. And they will not intercept until the person that holding the indugu has finished saying what he want to say and handing it over to the next person or the other one who has raised the hand to want to speak. But that, again, you could see it's something that happens without verbalizing it. You know, the practicality of it is that the indugu gets handed over. People don't say, here's an indugu, now you can talk. No, he says what he said. And then he just heads the indugu. Then they know he's finished talking. Mm. And the one who receives the indugu knows now it is time to actually talk. So it is such a marvelous a process that you see happening without a specific person conducting it, you know. Because the chief at that particular stage, he's an equal to his people. And that's what makes them feeling comfortable, because the chief is not like that overall person that will be holding a stick like a teacher or someone. You know, I like the terminology because Coach Tsima said it in the book where he said, in Sepedi, they say that Hoshi Haibushi Yarena, you know. So simply saying that the king does not prescribe, instead he leads. You know, he doesn't say to the people, this is how you should do it. He leads the topic and he allows them to define the problem and come up with what will be the solution, which he will at the end of the process summarize it in the implementable language, and people will be knowing what is going to happen. So the nice thing about being the servant leadership in this case is that as a chief, you also don't need to be that brilliant and genius individual that knows everything. You know, you have an opportunity of your gifted, clever or intelligent people among in the village, they will also have an opportunity to actually lead or give their inputs during that particular time. And using this very format of sharing and then talking only when you are on the floor. So the chief, hence I say the facilitation methodology is conscious on him. He is watching as the stick gets handed over from one person to another. And he can see at a certain stage that no. But that this so and so and that this so and so are dominating the discussion and therefore are not giving the others an opportunity to actually talk. But also these others are silent because they are not raising their hands. Remember, the indicate given to you once you indicate that you would like to say something. But the chief, as he's facilitating the process, he then realizes that so-and-so and so-and-so have been quiet. He will then call the stick to him, back to the chief. And the chief will start using the eye contact, you know, to be then kind of signaling that I am coming to you. I am going to make sure that this stick gets handed over to you so that at least you can talk, you know. So it gives the opportunity of those that are shy, you know. I mean, I will feel proud when the chief respects me in such a way that he says, I want to hear your opinion.
Yeah.
And, you know, he then hands me the stick without me having raised my hands. So he basically says to me, I will respect your opinion. I want you to say something because I do believe that you could help us in this issue that we are dealing with. And in such a way, such people also get encouraged to really want to contribute something because I don't want to disappoint my chief that I respect so much. If he gives me a stick, I better say something, you know. I better contribute and then give it in that sense. So at that particular stage, those dominating people, they are then also given an opportunity. I think that Tsima explained it quite well in the book somewhere, to say that they are also then given an opportunity to learn the listening skills, because they are now not domineering anymore, but they are being given that chance to say, now be quiet and listen to this other input that we have never heard it before. You know, so the people get to also learn those particular skills at the same time. So back in the boardroom, we tend to be sitting with a situation where there will be a manager, and the manager and their particular seat that they are sitting, or the leader at the particular time, he's at the bigger chair. You know, we might be saying things to want to please him, but to want to get the acknowledgement of that, because he is of a higher value. And only when he kind of shows his body language of nodding, then you kind of know that, okay, I'm saying the right thing. But because the chief is around you, he's sitting in the circle, you cannot necessarily want to actually show him the nodding and whatever, because he is equal to you. You know, so the pleasing and not being real situation, because the practicality of a boardroom sometimes is that we tend to want to say what pleases the one who is in authority, you know. And the one who's in authority, he is sitting there domineering with just the body language and just the chair. Because I like this concept of just saying, you even try to move away from that chair. You don't want to be honest, because you know, if you are not going to be pleasing and really subjecting yourself into that particular person who's sitting in that chair, you kind of are in trouble, you know. And it might not be an open trouble, but it's already sometimes we can say a career limiting type of body language or statements that might be said. But the concept of LEKGOTLA, the advantage of it is that you are all equal. Your own chief is your equal at the time, you know. the only showing of him being a chief is because he will be having the stick right at the beginning and introducing the topic. From there, when the meeting continues, you really don't see him as a chief as such. Mm. So that is, to me, the strong concept into the richness of it as an African methodology of conducting what one would say it's a way of running a meeting. So I agree in Tatizima. My view is that we have to bring up something that is an African way of doing, African way of running a business meeting, which at the end of the day could be used in any setup of wanting to come up with a business solution. And, you know, we could actually have it to be learned in a way that it becomes one of a concept that is used, understanding where it's originated from. Yeah. You know,
and I would like to liken it to the many other famous models or concepts that are used. I mean, the closest one for me is the World Cafe. Yes. You know, or you were talking about the cycles. What do you call it? The World Cafe is the one that I really can relate to. And then, of course, The Time to Think by Nancy Klein, because they all have certain dignified way of conducting conversations. Mm-hmm. And this one, the way is so natural and it's easy to observe. If you could really convince the colleagues in the boardroom that they let it be tried, because what we tried to do with the manual was actually to do exactly that, that you still need the modern principles of explain to us how is it going to help us. Mm. Because you have to convince people. And I'm saying it's going to help you because, number one, it removes the pressures that people find themselves under. And as you said, it allows everybody to be given equal chance and to be heard and listened to and be heard. Mm. And therefore, all those are the things that distract us when we are sitting in boardrooms trying to resolve issues. Yeah. So once we have done that, you will find that a number of the principles that are applied in LEKGOTLA, you will find them in World Cafe, you will find them in brainstorming methodologies, you'll find them in Nancy Klein's Time to Think, yeah. You'll find it in Conscious Leadership Model. It's just that those happen to be very well written in textbooks and are in the technology platforms, yeah. But you don't find the LEKGOTLA. But I know one guy in Holland that spent a lot of time in Botswana researching it and took it over to Europe and is using it in facilitating conflict resolutions discussions. We have our very own. You go to funerals, you go to weddings, you go to, in every little village, you never find elders sitting scattered. They are all in a circle. And once you are in the circle, you are part of them.
Exactly. Yes. Yes. Mm. Yes. That's true.
Rammutla, you wanted to go deeper into the chapter. Over to you, my
Thank you very much, Sylvia. You covered much of the information in the book. I just want to highlight to the listeners that in the book, Prasem is indicating that LEKGOTLA must not be confused with Imbizo or Pito or a town hall, because these are not the same. LEKGOTLA is a leadership meeting, as Sylvia has said. In our modern context, it is regarded as a meeting facilitation methodology. It evolved traditionally over time. As Sylvia has said, this is not, LEKGOTLA is not the thing that is recent. It evolved traditionally. So once the LEKGOTLA has resolved matters or taken decision in a particular direction which affects the people of the village, His Majesty may decide to call a town hall or an imbizo or kopano ya sechaba to update them on the decisions of the leadership from the LEKGOTLA. There may be some actions that must be taken by the households of the village collectively. In the modern era, we call it the action plan. That is, that they have to start the planting season or harvest season. So in that case, they must collectively harvest for the royal family first before they harvest for themselves. So yeah, this is an essential practice because the king is responsible for keeping seeds from the harvest for the whole village and storing the crop in case of another outbreak of hunger. So at this stage, I would like to venture into what is the contribution to the current and future generations. Oh, but before I do that, let me give Mike the opportunity to just to roll out the application of the LEKGOTLA as outlined in the manual that is developed by Prasen. Mike?
Thank you, Dr. Rammutla. Yes, some did indicate in the manual that the practical application of LEKGOTLA, I think by writing this was just to bring an order into how do we do it in 2017 when we were trying by all means to practice it and put it into a reality. The first step was the arrival and registration so that we can keep information of who attended and which organization do they represent, and also keep their details for the future, LEKGOTLA, to get an invitation. And the second step was about the pre-LEKGOTLA networking. Basically, what happens is just we get to interact with some of the guests. We can interact with, by that time, you can get a business or you can get certain issue or get certain explanation of a certain item. And then step three is the process of checking in. When we check in, we allocate the participant into their various mini LEKGOTLA before we can head to the main LEKGOTLA for them to give us what they've discussed on a meeting, and also to get to discuss on their mini LEKGOTLA what was discussed in the main LEKGOTLA. And also the we must also remember that the main LEKGOTLA is also done in a circle format, as I think it was Motubatse that indicated that it's for eye contact and also to see who's talking and what issue do they bring to the table. And in that main LEKGOTLA, what happens is we get to, at some point in 2017, they were inviting guest speakers to do their presentation. If it's about the wheel, work integrated learning, they get to explain in detail, and we get to extract themes from that presentation. Yes, and in the mini LEKGOTLA, because by just after the presentation, we'll head to the mini LEKGOTLA and discuss those themes that we managed to get from the main LEKGOTLA. And in that mini LEKGOTLA, we're also going to describe our chairperson, scriber, and give our group name and also have the methodology behind that name. And we're going to go back to report to the main LEKGOTLA through our scriber and also our spokesperson to give us what was discussed in the group, who are the main participants, who is the chair. Basically, it's introducing the participants in that group. Yeah, I think that the last step will be about checking out and discussing some of the issues and also try to create a mini dialogue and engage in all the themes that was discussed in the main LEKGOTLA. I hand it over to you, Rammutla.
Oh, thank you very much. I'm sure to continue with the manual that you are referring to, which we call the LEKGOTLA Way Learning and Development Methodology. In that manual, the LEKGOTLA methodology is defined as the African methodology for creating an environment favorable for active thinking, dialogue, engagement, learning, development, and resolving of conflicts. And you have spoken about dialogues, Mike, and you have demonstrated how we roll it out. But what is the value-adding role of those dialogues in the modern times? So we learn from that manual linked with the book that the methodology provides us with knowledge creation, knowledge consolidation, knowledge sharing, knowledge appreciation. And we also have the input here by Will Taylor, who talks about four stages of conscious learning, unconscious and incompetence, conscious and incompetence, conscious competence, and conscious competence. And then we continue, the dialogue provides us with knowledge exchange, knowledge application, knowledge management, and knowledge preservation. So the manual, in line with the book as well, it tells us about the LEKGOTLA concept. What is the origin? Where does it originate from? So in the overview, we learned that the participants demonstrate the highest respect of fellow members of the LEKGOTLA.
Mm.
And the participant who's on the floor is given full space to raise issues without being interrupted. Once all the participants have raised their issues and have fully been heard, the chairperson summarizes the inputs and a resolution is taken. People are also allowed to agree to disagree. Indeed, this is the best South African export in management, leadership, negotiations, and conflict resolutions to the world.
Mm.
We are very much unique and we have something to contribute to the whole world.
Mm.
So, yeah, Mike has talked about the practical application and the steps undertaken from arrival and registration to voluntary post-LEKGOTLA networking.
Mm.
So what is the philosophy behind the LEKGOTLA? As per Mike has said, monthly face-to-face interactions and joint learning, platform for collective creating new knowledge, themes for social media platforms, knowledge exchange, and also bodies of knowledge. The monthly themes deliberated in the LEKGOTLA constitute a diverse grouping of bodies of knowledge. So, continuing, Brasem, the LEKGOTLA also provide a captive source and home for researchers. Collaboration in learning and catching up with trends, fun and exchanging ideas, networking with thought leaders, reconnecting with busy professionals, We all know that the professionals are very busy, but the LEKGOTLA way will give them the opportunity for reconnecting and networking. Relevance in knowledge and information age, motivation for authors, growing the readers market, mobile LEKGOTLA on demands. Yeah, we started the LEKGOTLA in Gauteng, but I think we'll roll it out in other provinces. Networking. Listeners, the methodology also provided a thinking environment. And in our LEKGOTLA methodology, it is inspired by the thinking environment. As described, Prasem was talking about time to think, listening to ignite the human mind by Nancy Klein. So, yeah, we also have continuous professional development that we are promoting with our methodology. So we have developed this LEKGOTLA learning methodology from the perspectives of a continuous professional development interventions. We'd like our participants to attend the networks on an annual basis to renew their knowledge, catch up with trends and new standards. Yes, after we have involved everybody in the learning process and continuous professional development, we do certification of competence and acceptance. All the participants who attend a minimum of 6 LEKGOTLA will receive the certificate of competence and acceptance from the COMETSA PMS LEKGOTLA networks. This certificate qualifies the recipients as experts on the LEKGOTLA way, learning and development methodology. This is a precondition to become the host, program director, facilitator, and co-facilitator. So yeah, once we have this, we also have our volunteer network champions, our volunteer panel of network experts, our annual summit of COMETSA PMS panel of network experts, and our annual LEKGOTLA conference for network participants. Yeah, with the module, we have a tool that we can really provide an opportunity for our leaders to come and join the COMETSA PMS network. Let me at this stage, or maybe I'll give it at the end. Let me at this stage indicate to the listeners that we will be waiting for them to join us. They can do so by contacting our administrator, Michael Molaba, at call center at COMETSA -goc.com, or they can call him at 0117949308, or visit our website www.semtsima.com or www.comesadevelopment.com or www.comesa-goc.com. So yeah, we will very much appreciate if all the listeners can come and join us at the COMETSA LEKGOTLA way methodology. Let me at this stage share with you some of the so-called problem statements, but problem statements or challenges. As I was reading Sam's book, I found that there are some challenges that he has highlighted, and at the same time provide some recommendations to intervene. So yeah, he has indicated to us that it is common knowledge that the professionals, academic students, and industrialists are busy. So they cannot disengage from their professional work. So our LEKGOTLA demonstrate to these professionals that they can have fun while fulfilling their duties. We are also bringing in other practitioners from other sectors. There is a belief that intellectuals have been sidelined in the new South Africa. Brasem says, I'm afraid I must disagree with this assertion. They are missing platforms where they are affirmed. They have a huge role to play in this country. As constitutional democracy is further developed in this country, the intellectuals will be sought to inform policies, strategies, and practices. So the second one, the thought leaders are the most difficult people to bring under one roof. Indeed, in the LEKGOTLA spirit, we treat each thought leader and professional as a unique individual while supporting them to interact and network with fellow thought leaders in a trusted atmosphere. As Mike has said, in our networks, monthly networks, we invite professionals, we give them the opportunity to present in terms of their skills and knowledge, and we give them the opportunity to be listened to and for us to ask questions for them to respond. So the venue, South Africa is not a big country, yet professionals can spend years without meeting and seeing each other. So professionals and colleagues must be able to meet each other with little or no effort. This is what modern LEKGOTLA offers professionals. Lastly, it has been several years since the information age, so we are still in it and would like to make maximum benefit of it. So I want to contribute that this is Prasem. He wants to contribute to this age. It is not necessary as stressful as many believe. It requires us to have a positive attitude towards it. We must appreciate the role that technology plays in this age. Technology is an enabler rather than a nuisance, and we can engage with technology rather than stress about it. The worst mistake is to have a negative attitude toward this age and reject technology. We all know that many people are afraid of coming close to a computer.
That's true.
Yeah. So we will be further isolated because of our resistance. Just imagine, right now we have our innovation of COMETSA worldwide radio. As we speak now, we are international. So without it, we would have to board the plane and go and present to the conferences overseas. So LEKGOTLA holds the networks with topics that will offer opinions to professionals on how to engage in this era. So this era is going to be more disempowering than we think. For example, technology will drive our vehicles. That will be nice for us just to see it in the car go. You program it, it takes you to Kempton Park. They will service us. They will diagnose diseases. That will be nice. Diagnose diseases and store information in the cloud, as is already the case. This could become scary. It will increase our fears and stress levels. So let us embrace the changes and technology trends in our lives. I think this was the highlights that were brought by Brasem, making observations of some of the challenges and providing some recommendation. So at this stage, Sylvia and Mike, I don't know if you have anything to add on this.
Yeah, I think from my side, I really appreciate the intention of taking this further, you know, and probably also from what you are saying, that the LEKGOTLA way is basically a very effective tool that we can even research it further to ensure that it's a worldwide implemented tool to be used in the businesses. When you talk about the technology, I was sharing earlier on that I was watching at one stage on the news. I think it was a documentary or something on Al Jazeera for some reason, and they were interviewing a robot that is a human. I don't know whether I should say it's a human being or it's a person. But, you know, I mean, this is like a lady which is like formed in whatever standard of a woman, talking and answering questions and, you know, being told that this is what she's coming to do. She's a robot, but she's coming to serve. She's not here to harm the people, you know, and all that. But the thing is, I'm looking at this thing. It's a human being, you know, dressed up, you know, hairstyles and all these other things. But it's a robot. And it's okay. I don't know whether one has to define it in terms of, but it's a robot at the end of the day, you know, the practicality of it. And I was looking at it, and now when we are advised here, as Ntatizima say, let us embrace the technology as it comes. And I'm thinking of this robot, and I'm saying, yo, I so wish at one stage we could have an opportunity of inviting such a robot to sit in the LEKGOTLA, you know, and let it be part of the participants. And let's just see on how they will acknowledge, because this is like a tool that also has to be learned, a tool that will have to be programmed into this robot that is now programmed to be answering questions and doing things. So these are the concepts that we can basically engage in and interact with the researchers or the gurus of technology to say, you know, program this thing that it can also be able to participate in a LEKGOTLA type of a methodology process that is taking place. And, you know, that to me is part of how one could be saying that we are embracing this technology, because we accept that this robot is here. You know, at one stage, as you say, the cars will be driving itself. You know, we will be having these robots assisting us in meetings, in whatever. So it will be good that it get programmed to be able to do the LEKGOTLA way. You know, no,
thank you very much. We are heading towards the end of the program, but one would ask the question, what is the value-adding role of the LEKGOTLA methodology? Prasam says it facilitates deep thinking, creativity, listening, flowing dialogue, consultation before a decision is made, verification of the decisions taken, and discussions until everybody is satisfied that they made their input. It is also, the methodology is appropriate for divergent style of learning and development. Because during the deliberations, the king is patient and allows the conversation to diverge. So yeah, I think let's go towards checking out. I'll start with Mike, and then followed by Sylvia, and then I'll conclude.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Rammutla.
And I think, Mike, the framework for checking out, we discuss it, if you can follow it and check out.
Yes. I'm just going to follow it, the checking out formation that we've been using in our quota. The confirmation, as I was going through this process and also comparing with the book, it confirms to me that actually the LEKGOTLA way methodology is a critical point we can use through the mentorship process and guidance. The reason why I'm saying this is because it emphasized that it brings both the elders and the young ones together to discuss a certain common theme. And of course, the experienced one will bring more knowledge and experience and diverse knowledge due to their concept of learning more. And the aha moment, it's how Ms. Sylvia was explaining it. It was like she was with us in the 2017 LEKGOTLA, because what she was explaining is what we went through the whole 2017 year. Mm-hmm. And new insights is basically how it's been practiced in the modern aspects, because we thought that how it was designed was basically meant for the traditional ways of discussing the themes. But now as it's been brought forward as a theme and also as a methodology to facilitate some of the strategy or all the sessions that are related. What I'm taking home is to be humble, actually, and try to engage more into dialogues. The more I'm going to engage into dialogues, I think is the more I'm going to learn more and be more experienced than my age, of course. And new behavior. It's basically to become a new person, you know, to become a new person and try to also meet up with some of the researchers that are undergoing through the concept of LEKGOTLA. Probably will get more themes to add on to the manual that STEM have designed for us. I think that's it for my side.
Oh, thank you very much, Sylvia.
Okay, thank you. I think I will just summarize it much quicker because I see the time is gone. But I think for me, the confirmation is quite more in terms of just saying that it's an effective tool that I believe that it can be used, and maybe even beyond with the mentorship and coaching perspective, even in a practical sense of a normal day-to-day running of a business, when you were to facilitate very critical sessions of strategy formulations. And the aha moment for me is, I think, also listening to how you have taken us through in terms of, you know, how to fit it where it comes up, and especially the different professional certificates that have been mentioned in here. They are just indicating to me more of a new insight and knowledge. To be honest, I just feel, and I'm looking at it and I say, one won't lose anything to actually, even starting from now, with whatever experience, putting this into practice with these different qualifications that are mentioned here. Very much required, and I would encourage people, you know, to actually take this quite seriously and be involved in these sessions and going through it. Myself, what I take home is I need it myself. I personally would like to actually go through these different sessions and, you know, a continuous learning approach, because one can't say you've got it all or you know it all in all of it. The new behaviors are to ensure that one puts it into practice consciously, and not only in terms of just reading it on the paper, but see yourself applying the methodology as in terms of running the business interactions.
Oh, thank you very much. From my side, the confirmation is that this is the best conflict resolution, leadership, and human capital management that South Africa can offer worldwide. The aha moment, at every stage of the book and the chapter, when you think that Brasem has reached a deadline or a dead stop, something comes. He's very innovative and creative. As we speak now, we're talking about continuous professional development. We're talking about rolling out the program, certification of...